1, 2, 3. Welcome to Arts and Leisure on the HAN Network. This is our weekly program featuring everything that is coming up in the area's music, arts, and entertainment scene. We will interview local artists, authors, musicians, and even some nationally recognized names who may be performing here in our area. We will have movie reviews and film suggestions from the real dad, Mark Schumann, and etiquette tips from Catherine Michaels. This is your all-access pass, and here are your hosts, Arts and Leisure editor Sally Sanders and our entertainment reporter, Steve Coulter.
Good afternoon. Welcome to Arts and Leisure on the HAN Network. I'm your host, Steve Coulter. I'm joined here on the couch with Sally Sanders, as always, and Kate Chapunsky of Coffee Break.
Yes.
Kate,
yeah.
Thanks for joining
guest.
Us.
We're yeah, joining you guys.
We're going to have a nice, fun TV talk today. There's no really good movies out, so why not dive right into the best of the kind of winter, spring season. And we're going to start with the end of the era in England, Downton Abbey. Every year has its show that ends. Last year was Mad Men. This year is Downton Abbey,
right.
A truly classic television show, one of the best of all time. Were you guys weeping on Sunday night when it aired?
It was so happy, though.
It was so happy. I think I read one reviewer said it was an American end to a British story because he really didn't throw us any, you know, sad, upsetting curveballs.
Well, and
nobody died in a car accident.
No. We've gotten some of that in the past. Obviously, Matthew Crawley, poor Sybil. We've lost some folks.
But Anna being raped. I mean,
that was devastating when that happened.
And Anna being in prison and Bates being in prison. It really was lovely. And of course, the hardest luck person of all, getting the best wedding at the end.
I know.
Yeah,
Edith.
Was Edith.
Edith, who's
she finally found romance.
As her father said, poor Edith couldn't even get her dolls to do what she wanted when she was little, but she finally found happiness.
Oh, that's good, because when I was watching,
she outranks her family now.
Yes. She was so single and lonely.
She married up too.
Oh, really?
Higher status, higher title, which was obviously a big deal.
Kind of a nebbishy guy, I thought, but still.
Yes. Yeah.
What happened to all the servants downstairs?
Oh, wonderful things.
Yeah.
Barrow, you have...
I love Barrow. I think he's so great. Yeah, he's so dark.
I know
he reminds me of Alan Rickman.
He's lightened up, though.
Oh, Barrow in the end comes... Do you want to know the spoilers?
No.
Yeah,
no
spoiler
alert. No. I'm going to catch up. I watched the first four seasons.
Okay, we shouldn't tell you more, except to say that Barrow does have a happy ending.
Oh, that's good. I always liked him, even though he's devious and... He's
oh my gosh,
dark.
That first season of Barrow, O'Brien is like the best thing. They're always outside smoking cigarettes and scheming.
Yeah.
They're kind of lost.
They're
down
so,
there,
they're so scheming.
It's pretty great.
Daisy is the cook.
Oh, she just gets on my nerves. I mean, she had a little growing moment, I think.
She did.
There.
Yes. Yeah. And Mrs. Patmore, I think, is going to find romance.
Yes.
You know, you
mostly
can
everyone finding romance at the end of Downton Abbey.
You can see that Julian Fellowes could write a film after this, or he could pick up some of the characters and take us somewhere. Like, he could just focus on Edith and her lord or whatever. Is he an earl?
He's a marquess. How do you say it? Marquess, I think you say.
Marquess, yes.
Yeah, and
okay.
She's I forget what you become with that.
Countess?
No, not a countess. Marchioness. A marchioness or something.
Yeah.
You learned so much about British royalty while watching the show.
I've read the word. I've never had to say it out loud. So, but yeah.
And so where does season 6 rank for you guys? Is it one of the best?
You know, I really think it was very sweet and sentimental. It didn't have a lot of the edge. That
not a lot of
the
bite.
Past.
I think the first, you know, the first couple of seasons really were the high point.
Yes.
And I think, you know, he coasted in places after
that.
But it's a lot to fill. I mean, he was doing all those episodes every year, and they were filming from I think August until May. So there wasn't a lot of time off.
Right.
He was writing, and they were filming it as he was writing it.
And we were talking about go ahead.
You know, I was going to say I was telling some of our coworkers yesterday is you know, the season premieres in the UK before it comes over here. It takes about a year. And I made the mistake of going to the Daily Mail website, like, right after
they
Christmas.
Had spoilers.
And they had a huge story across it about the end of the show.
Yeah, you want to avoid English
news.
And
it had a photo. It had Edith's wedding. And I was so I knew. But I didn't read it. I mean, but I just saw that.
So you knew she was getting married.
I knew that was going to happen, unfortunately, because of that. My mistake of going to a British website.
It doesn't really spoil it for you, though. You still have to go through it.
You got to go through it with the characters.
But we have many more things to look forward
to
now.
And that's an interesting contrast, because you kind of get the spoiler alert with Downton Abbey, because it is in the UK. And then the show that just came out last Friday, the fourth season of House of Cards, binge mode style watching.
Steve could tell us the whole season already.
You know, I promised that I wasn't going to watch it all, but... Sure enough, by last night, I finished all 13 episodes. And without giving away too much, let's just say that Kevin Spacey becomes Kaiser Soze in the end. He's very familiar
well,
territory for Kevin Spacey.
Is that picture of him with the blood on his hands? Is that
No. They,
that's from season one.
This season one, I'm pretty sure. Yeah. But he is. Yeah. What he does in the end of season four is it's Usual Suspects-esque.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
He is
in very familiar terrain, and the final scene with him and Robin Wright is just like one of the best.
Oh,
and
good.
Yeah, for people that turned it off in season three because it wasn't that good last year, it really gets good.
Now,
there
is this the last season for them, do you think?
No, they're going to do another one next year.
Okay.
Netflix
okay.
just keeps extending these shows. Orange is the New Black is going
to
be seven or eight seasons,
yeah.
they're
that
saying.
That I started with. I kind of lost interest, though.
How is she supposed to be in prison for eight seasons? It's a 15
month
stint.
You know what, though? If you go back to it after a while, you get so wrapped up in the characters in that. And she continues to give you the backstory of every person, and that's one of the most fun things about that show was the way she structured the.
And now, do you binge Orange Is the New Black?
I do it in spurts.
You
know,
I'll do
about four or five of them.
Yeah.
And then I'll stop it for a while.
And so, how does it vary between the week to week? You talk to coworkers, you talk to friends about Downton Abbey, versus you're watching all 13 in a matter of 4 or 5 days, and if someone hasn't watched it. You don't really have that same conversation. How is that different?
It does change things. It's like
and you have to be courteous. You know, you don't want to ruin the spoilers.
But it's like Breaking Bad. Now, I have that on my list of things to do, but I've never watched the whole series, and I know little bits of it just from hearing people talking about it. But
well, now you've got Better Call Saul, which
Better Call
season
Saul.
Season two
came
out.
Yeah, I'm only on season one of that.
Right.
Have you seen that one?
I haven't watched that show, no.
There's Bob Odenkirk
Bob Odenkirk is the best. And
Michael, Ehrmantraut. that's a character.
Jonathan Banks, the actor. He is.
Ehrmantraut's such a great name. I don't know where they came up with that, but it's so great.
Yes.
Well, but I think with some of those shows that are really well done, I mean, if you hear someone talking about a few details, does it really ruin it for you?
No.
I'd still watch it. You know what I mean? With some of those shows that are so well done. You know, like if somebody heard me talk about the end of Mad Men, I mean, if I was them and I hadn't watched it, I'd still watch it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. My husband's
By the way,
just
I love
going
the end of
through
Mad Men.
I think he's in about season four now. He's amazed by it. He didn't watch it when it first came out, and I can't wait for him to get to the end.
Oh, it's so good.
Exciting.
And it's interesting about Mad Men and, you know, Better Call Saul, and you've got House of Cards, really was, I think, kind of the show that came on the scene February of 2013, is there's no longer this emphasis to make your show in the fall, which it used to be. If you're not in the fall, you are a nothing show. That script has been completely rewritten.
Yeah, it was very rare that something would come out, after Christmas and be
successful.
Yeah.
House of Cards was wildly successful in its first season. You see, Downton Abbey always comes out after Christmas,
right?
Yeah. Well, the Masterpiece Theater schedule is kind of a year-round cycle anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And there's so many other ones. You've got Vinyl on HBO that came out.
I'm loving that so far. Yeah, that's a good one.
When he kung fu chops Ray Romano in the second episode, I think that might have been the most satisfying moment of TV in a very long time.
Really good.
Not to give away too many spoilers.
I am liking where that show's going.
Yeah,
very
it's really...
And, you know, I just love the 70s clothes. Like, just show it to me. I just love to see, you know, what everyone
the
was wearing. And all the different styles.
And Bobby Cannavale, I think he can carry anything.
Yes, he's amazing. I mean, sometimes just his expressions are just incredible, especially when he's listening to a new artist that's exciting him. It's very cool.
Right.
Gets
and then
dazed look.
The other show we had to talk about that came out in February, I don't know if you've been watching it, Kate, but Sally and I have, is The People versus O.J. Simpson.
Yeah, I've caught some of it here and there, and I'm not caught up.
Yeah.
But I was just listening to Sarah Paulson on Fresh Air actually talk about the Marcia Clark character. Now, that is so
fascinating. She had a big episode on Tuesday night.
That's what I heard. Yeah. I heard about that episode. I haven't watched it yet. Yeah.
And, Sarah Paulson and Courtney B. Vance, who's playing Johnny Cochran, they're sprinting away with the Emmys. It's like it's already wrapped up. I don't know when the Emmys are. I think they're in September.
Yeah.
Oh, hands down. They will sweep the Emmys, both of them. They are terrific.
Incredible acting.
What he's doing with the Cochran character is like unreal. It's like he's almost reinventing someone that's
so
public.
He's so calculating.
Yeah.
He's just so, I mean, there's always something going on behind,
right.
You know.
Mm-hmm. I just love the scenes even when he's not in the courtroom, when he's just reciting his dialogue with his wife and they're kind of bantering back with each other. It's just such great acting.
Yeah.
Amazing.
And
the
dialogue.
Redemption of Marcia Clark, thanks to Sarah Paulson's character. I mean, poor Marcia Clark.
Well, the hair, though. The hair.
I know.
Well,
the hair. Everyone still hates. That
the
hasn't
90s
changed.
Perm.
It's never good.
And what's really interesting about People versus O.J. is it's like so, we were talking about it before the show, it's like so meta that you've got the Kardashians running around. around, and then you have these serious performances that are going to go on, I think, to win Emmys, hands down. And you have all these, you know, racial tensions and great drama, but then you have these like hammy performances with John Travolta and David Schwimmer as Robert Kardashian. And you, even OJ himself, played by Cuba Gooding Jr., is just like, you can't really buy it, but at the same time, it's such a good show that you're completely enthralled. It's unlike anything I've ever watched
really
before.
Well really well done,
MTV.
Really interesting, and really showing all parts of it.
And I think that, that's the answer to it, is if you get really good actors in these short season series, it doesn't matter when you start them. People will find them and watch them.
You wanted to talk about American Crime, which is also same kind of format. They're going to be the same title almost. American Crime is on ABC. And then American Crime Story is on FX.
Yes.
And they're both miniseries. So next year, American Crime Story, the OJ one, is going to be completely different. And American Crime is season two now, completely different.
With kind of a repertory company, they have Felicity Huffman and Timothy Hutton and Regina King were all in last year's, and they're all in this year's. And the story is basically a look at race and how it's race and class.
And Regina King is so good.
And everything is switched upside down. So it's a very interesting, you know, it's a poor white kid who's abused by wealthy kids at a prep school, and but the person who gets nailed for it is the wealthy black kid.
Right.
And we go from there. It's very interesting.
That's on ABC?
Yeah, ABC is trying to steal the thunder from FX.
Well, that's on FX. No,
American Crime's on ABC.
Have I got that?
With Timothy Hutton, yeah.
Yeah, because People versus O.J.
Oh,
is
okay,
on FX.
That's right, okay.
Yeah, but they sound so similar.
Well, that's the thing, you know, and that's another interesting thing is that the major networks don't really pay attention to where things are anymore.
Right, and sometimes they're even on websites like Hulu. I've been watching 11/22/63 with James Franco.
I've been hearing
my girlfriend and I have been
things,
watching it, and it is really fascinating stuff. The whole time travel
based on a Stephen King book,
right? Yeah. And he's right there. He's looking out the window, and boom, they take the photo of. Now I'm drawing a blank on his name. No, thank you.
Patton also.
Yeah, and he's right there with the gun, and it's like he's there for that historical moment, and it's pretty cool in Dallas. And it's a really well done show.
Ah.
A little too much love storyline, but it's kind of predictable. You knew that they were going to go that route in the first episode when they introduced this damsel in distress in Dallas when they're first kind of scoping out the terrain down there.
Oh, that's interesting. I'll have to
check that one out. Yeah, it's on Hulu, which is, again, just so many different avenues to watch shows. There's
so what are you looking forward to?
The big one is Game of Thrones.
Of course.
That kind of goes back to our previous theme that winter and spring have just taken over.
Now,
HBO has put all of its money into the spring, which it just, I don't think it cares about its fall programming as much anymore. You've got Veep, you've got Silicon Valley, and those two are followed by, I mean, actually Game of Thrones precedes Veep and Silicon Valley, but that lineup, that menu is unbeatable by any network on
TV. Well, what's great for Game of Thrones, for anyone like, you know, dork like me that read the books, is this is now beyond the books.
Right.
So I have no idea
we're
what's
all
going on.
Playing
even
though
they changed a lot of good things that I think they made some great decisions about, you
did
know,
you
the
see
books.
Jon Snow in the trailer or no?
I didn't see him, but I have my own theories. I think he is alive, but I have theories about how and in which way, because as I said, it's beyond the book, so I don't know.
There's a BuzzFeed article where it's like 27 things that you can see in the trailer. It's wild. People really dissect it. What are you guys looking forward to coming up?
I am looking forward to the return of Grace and Frankie.
Okay. That's on Netflix.
That's on Netflix. And
Netflix just keeps pouring them out. They got Bloodline coming out in two weeks,
and
too.
And I'm intrigued by this one, which I think is also Netflix, which is called The Get Down. That's going to be in August. Mm. And it's a Baz Luhrmann drama with,
that's
get this,
unlike anything they've
Jimmy
ever put out.
Jimmy Smits, Giancarlo Esposito, and Jaden Smith.
Wow. Yeah, that
what?
Is great. That is awesome.
Giancarlo Esposito, a Ridgefield native, too.
Yeah.
You just got Eric to stand up.
Yeah. resident,
our director
anyway.
Just stood up out of shock.
And I'll throw one out, too, on Amazon, which is also
We forgot to mention Amazon. Good call.
I mean, they just finished their season with Mozart in the Jungle.
Right.
Which is really
Golden
fun.
Golden Globe winner.
And that's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a surprise. But Bosch, which stars Titus Welliver.
Oh, I love
is
him.
Is a great... just L.A. noir mystery.
Oh, cool.
I've been meaning to pick that up. I don't have an Amazon subscription, but I do want to watch Bosch.
Yeah,
I do like Titus.
That's really good. That's really good.
Yeah. And then Billions is on Showtime, of course.
Billions. Haven't watched that yet.
You gotta, everyone's got to watch Billions. It's probably the most fun you can have on TV.
Happen Leonard on Sundance also.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's Michael K. Williams' new show, right?
Yep.
All right. Well, there's a lot to watch. The winter and spring season is loaded. You can watch it on Netflix. You can watch it on Amazon.
And if there are films to see in the theater, this is the time.
There's plenty of TV to catch up on. There's so much. It's not even funny. Get your subscriptions to all these different sites, HBO, all of them. We're going to head to a break. We've got the Greater Bridgeport Symphony coming on next to talk about
Not the entire symphony.
Yeah, not all 80, not all 80 members, but their show is coming up on Saturday night. We'll be right back after the break.
Darien Sports Shop is a unique store because it's a family store. A busy mom can come in with kids in tow and find everything she needs for them, and even find a dress for herself for Saturday night. And if she's in a rush, she can simply go home and order it from us that night. We'll deliver it the next day. The Darien Sports Shop. We're pretty on the outside and amazing on the inside. Conveniently located with free and easy parking at 1127 Post Road, Darien, Connecticut. Or shop us online at dariensport.com.
When you experience a sports injury, you want to get better and fast. Coastal Ortho Express gives you direct access to orthopedic care quickly. Their physicians are fellowship-trained in sports medicine at world-class universities and are also team doctors for area football teams. For specialized personal care of sports injuries, go to Coastal Ortho Express. Open Monday through Saturday in the iPark building, 761 Main Avenue in Norwalk, or CoastalOrthoExpress.com. Coastal Orthopedics, keeping you on the move.
Walter Stewart's Market in New Canaan is your time-saving local shopping destination for the best of spring. Find many of your favorite products, from great specials on everyday items to the freshest organic produce, artisanal cheeses, and grass-fed steaks. Drop off your knives to be sharpened, grab a beautiful bouquet of spring flowers, and stop in next door for a wine tasting. Plus, their personable staff is always ready to lend a helping hand. So stop in to Walter Stewart's Market, 229 Elm Street, today, or shop online at stewartsmarket.com.
Can't wait for it to get warmer so you can start fishing again? Get over to the Dock Shop, where they have the latest in fishing tackle, marine electronics, boating supplies, and more. But remember, the Dock Shop isn't your average tackle shop. You'll also find the finest selection of nautical apparel, jewelry, home decor, and gifts in New England. Boater, beach bum, fishermen, or simply love the New England coast, this is a unique place to shop. The Dock Shop, 51 Tokenique Road, Darien, 609 Riverside Avenue, Westport, DockShop.com.
For over 25 years, Mike Sizek Painting and Wallpapering has been the name to know for residential and commercial properties in Fairfield County. He uses only the top brands, including Benjamin Moore, for impeccable preparation and lasting quality. Call Mike now and receive $500 off any job over $7,000. Mike is currently accepting reservations for spring, so call him today at 203-770-8869 or 203-972-3310. For your custom painting, finishing, and staining needs, it's Mike Sizek.
I'm Kate Chaplinsky. Join us for Coffee Break weekdays at 11 to get the latest Connecticut news, weather, high school sports, and more. News doesn't get any more local than on Coffee Break on the HAN Network.
Welcome back to Arts and Leisure on the HAN Network. Sally and I are joined with Mark Halstead of the Greater Bridgeport Symphony.
Operations manager.
Thank you so much for coming back. You were what was it, November or December we had you on?
December. We're talking about Beethoven.
Beethoven. Now we're talking about Mahler. Mahler's coming up this weekend, 8 o'clock in Bridgeport.
That's right.
It's going to be huge, right?
That's the best word for it. You can try all kinds of adjectives and you keep coming back to huge. I have the privilege of getting to see them in rehearsal. And certainly I've heard this before, but to see it performed, and it's about 80 musicians on the stage, and it just comes right out at you.
Lots of brass,
so
right?
Powerful. Oh, lots of brass. There's a beautiful horn solo in the third movement. And last night, they skipped the beautiful fourth movement during the main rehearsal, but I had heard it in strings. And that's the Adagietto, which is so beautiful. And it just takes you away. I'm just so thrilled to see this happening, and it's the first time in over 30 years that the symphony.
You've got Mahler, yeah, and it's like the biggest I think you've put on in 10 years.
Yeah. I mean, usually we can get a very big sound out of 50 or 55 musicians. When we get up another 20 or 25,
you got to bring in the extra the reinforcements for this show.
Well, they had actually enlarged the stage at the Klein a little bit and take out the shell to be able to fit everything.
Oh, really? Yep. So you had to move some pieces around.
Yes, indeed.
Wow. Well, it's the 70th anniversary, so you've got to.
Yep. Well, actually, that's coming up. We have had our 70th season.
That's That's right.
Now we're going to be 70.
Yep.
So it's another celebratory year.
You got to go big or go home, right?
You betcha.
Do you actually add more strings as well, or is this?
Everything is bigger.
Everything is bigger.
Everything is bigger, yeah. And I have a few friends in the string section, and they brought me over to their stands last night. Look at this. Look at key signature change. Change, change, change. Tempo change. Look, look, look. So they are thrilled, but also...
challenged.
Yeah, and they love the challenge, though.
Yeah.
And you see them working it together and coming back over passages, and it's just going to be, by Saturday, it's going to be something transcendental, really.
Yeah.
How many hours of rehearsal have they done so far?
Oh, Eric's had them, let's see, 6 hours yesterday, 3 hours tonight, and 3 hours tomorrow night.
So they know Mahler now like the back of their hand, right?
Well, I think they all do. They love that this is Mahler, that Mahler's back, and I think they're thrilled to be playing it. And the energy comes out that they're all dedicated to this, that they know it's a challenge, it's big, it's daunting, and it's wonderful.
Yeah.
This is called The Giant.
Mm-hmm.
And it has five movements, which is unusual for a symphony. Normally we expect four.
Throws you a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah. But the first couple movements are the sadder parts, yes?
Well, he runs the whole gamut.
Yeah.
It starts out
with trumpet, which is very...
Yes. Well, interesting. Our office intern went into her old high school in Bridgeport, and she gave a presentation on Mahler, and this spurred some extra activity on our part. But when she came back with the survey information, the kids liked the music. Some of them loved it. And then they said it sounded like cartoon music, and they said, it reminds me of Tom and Jerry. And I'm thinking, Tom and Jerry was old when I was a kid. They're still watching it, but they're getting the anxiety of the music in some parts.
The tension.
The sort of chase scene in some other parts, and sort of the sly hoodwinking part. They're picking this up. And of course, then one of our board members chimed in with, well, that's true, because all of these composers that have come over from Europe
they're
in
using
the 30s
the same
and 40s
thing,
who were composing cartoon music, fleeing Hitler, we're sort of filching from Mahler every now and again.
Well, they also used actual pieces from classical work.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, I think my first exposure to classical music was probably cartoons, too.
Elmer Fudd, everybody
yeah.
knows. That's Kimball Abbott. Mm-hmm. Yep.
What's your favorite part of the entire
piece? I'm loving the Adagietto.
Yeah.
And I want to go back for more rehearsals because once is not going to be enough. I have to see it again and again. And I have to ask Eric when he's doing it again, so I'll time myself to get down.
And we've got Eric coming on soon.
Yes.
He's going to be playing the cello
mm-hmm.
after our next commercial break. But before we let you go, you've got 75 to 80 people playing. What's the biggest challenge of that?
Well, we have such a great and professional crew that the challenges are there, but they are completely unseen.
Right.
Our stage manager, our personnel manager, everything goes perfectly. Everybody gets in. Everybody does their job. Everybody loves doing their job. That's the most important part. And Eric makes it look easy.
Yeah. And from tickets still on sale?
Tickets are all on sale. You can go online
to
bptsim.org. You can call our office, 576-0263. We have a sort of special phone offer that we'll sell you tickets for $20 if you call and talk to us.
All right.
So if you call the office, we'll
get rewarded for human
interaction.
We want
to get as many people in as possible.
As, right.
as one of our people said this morning, if you miss this, you'll regret it. You'll hear it sometime and say, I could have seen that and felt that experience of Mahler being performed, and it's not to be missed.
And something like this live is really exceptional.
Yeah, with all those different pieces to it, it's incredible. Yeah.
We were in a high school yesterday, and one of the things that sort of impressed the kids is no amps, no amplification, no electronics. No, it's all right there. That's the music being crafted before your eyes.
Yeah.
And of course, the sound is so big that your whole body responds to the music. It's beautiful.
Well, hopefully people will turn out this weekend, 8 o'clock Saturday, March 12th. And then you've also got a show April 9th, is
yes,
that correct?
We do. That's,
so
we're
the season
very excited
keeps rolling.
About that one as well. Literally a smorgasbord.
Yeah.
The word is carefully chosen because it's all Northern European composers. We have, well, starting in England, we have Grieg, Sibelius, and Stravinsky. We're going to close with the Firebird Suite. We have a composition that was written for Eric by a modern Swedish composer as well. And many familiar themes in there, as well as real great classics. So that's going to be our season closer, and we're also very excited about
that.
So
keep the momentum rolling into the spring.
And then September 24th, we're already starting to look for next season, and we've got some great things brewing right now.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for coming on, Mark.
My
we appreciate
pleasure.
It. We're going to have Eric coming on after the break. to play some live music for us and talk more about this this weekend's show.
Find over 1,000 special stories at Hospital for Special Surgery. Go to hss.edu/backinthegame.
I was jogging 5 months after my cartilage tear.
Skiing a year after hip surgery.
And playing grandma 4 weeks after hip replacement.
One special hospital, 1,000 special stories. See Connecticut patients at hss.edu/CT.
I really wanted something that felt like a home. Coming from a big house, I wanted the feel of a home as opposed to a condo. The construction is incredible, whether it's the floors, the fireplace, the moldings, the lighting. It's as peaceful as my home was in the middle of the woods. It feels like a house. It does not feel like a condo or a townhome. I feel like I'm in my house.
I'm Denise DiGregoli, the host of The Drive on the HAN Network. Join me Tuesdays for some motivational, intelligent talk with a little humor as we visit with people who live their lives mindfully. Tune in to The Drive live on Tuesdays, 12:30, here on the HAN Network.
You are watching the HAN Network, and you're not alone. Nearly 500,000 viewers enjoyed our broadcast in the first 5 months. Advertise on the network that reaches Fairfield County, Connecticut's most engaged audience. Contact Jessica Murren, Advertising Director, at 203-273-7312 or email jessica@han.network.
Here at the Darien Sports Shop, we are very excited about our newly redesigned men's department. Gentlemen, if you're shopping for work, weekend, or wedding, we've got the latest styles and trends inside our spacious new department just for you. We have vast selections from Peter Millar, Vineyard Vines, Johnny O, Duckhead, Barber, and so much more. And you can even walk out of the store in the new Wolverine 1,000-mile men's boot. Conveniently located with free and easy parking at 1127 Post Road, Darien, Connecticut. Or shop us online at dariensport.com.
For more than 50 years, Triple S has been Fairfield County's expert service for carpet, upholstery, and drapery cleaning. We provide the best in repairs and in-depth restoration, understanding fabrics and how to properly clean and restore them. Our staff will come to your home to clean your wall-to-wall carpet to perfection. We can also pick up your fine carpets and bring them to our facilities. With locations in Norwalk, Stamford, and Stratford, Triple S will get the job done fast, big or small. At Triple S, you can count on our people as well as our cleaning.
Find us at tripleSclean.com or 203-847-8000.
Here at the Organic Yard, we use bio-nutritional products in our lawn care programs, which reduces the need for fertilizers, nitrates, phosphates, and pesticides up to 80%, making a safer environment for your family and pets. With our organic lawn treatment, you'll receive vigorous, healthy plants with improved root development and better drought resistance. Enroll now in our 2016 Organic Yard program and get a free organic deer tick treatment. Call us today at 914-764-5491 or go to our website at millerslandscapinginc.com. Here at the Organic Yard.
Welcome back to Arts and Leisure on the HAN Network. We've got music director Eric Jacobson here to play us a few minutes of live music on his cello. Eric, take it away.
Thank you.
Great job there by Eric, and he's going to lay down the cello. It's again, the show is Saturday night.
March 12th.
We got the director now on the couch with us.
Yeah. Be careful.
How long have you been playing the cello for?
Well, I have a family that's all musicians. My father played in the Met Opera for 35 years. My mom is a flutist.
Oh, wow.
My brother is a violinist, 4 years older. And I grew up playing, so I probably started when I was about 4 years old. And I was very gung-ho, only playing cello, you know, really into
it. A little baby cello? Or
Exactly. What I had was a viola, which is just only slightly bigger than a violin, with an end pin in it when I was pretty small. I was cuter back then. I had less facial hair then. And I fell in love with it as a thing that was done at the house. You know, we just heard it. And then at some point when I was probably 13, I thought, oh, I should do this. I should practice a lot and be good at this. But I always had this little desire to conduct. I guess doing the repertoire of orchestral music, getting to conduct Beethoven and Schubert and Brahms, and this weekend Mahler.
Mahler, yeah. Is this first time ever conducting?
This isn't my first time conducting Mahler, but but my first time on the symphony,
yeah.
Which is, of course, one of the greatest pieces ever written, sort of a pillar in history as classical music, sort of like you'd look at a Matisse and say that painting actually made such a special moment in history.
Why is Mahler not
cello.
As...
Okay. Sorry about that.
So sorry.
Why is Mahler not as well-known, as popular as Beethoven?
It's a good question. Mahler not known as much as Beethoven. Well, I think Beethoven sort of defines a time in the world. Beethoven was, you could compare it to Mozart and Haydn very closely because they're similar themes and similar harmonies and melodies. But he was sort of at the end of that cycle. So what he did was he took everything that came before and gave it such incredible new light, so sort of pushed the envelope past what's just the Mozart and Haydn, which, of course, I'm one of the biggest Mozart and Haydn fans. And I'd say that the most impressive thing about Beethoven is that today it's still modern and new. And not that all of these composers aren't.
You were modernizing Mahler yesterday at a high school nearby, right?
We had a great time at a high school, just going in and talking to students. The greatest thing is that students, generally speaking, if you catch them at the right time and you speak to them honestly, like that they're one of us. They're not just people that we approach to, but actually ask for information.
Right.
They're going to give the most incredible responses and be so collaborative in any type of presentation.
And what was that kind of conversation like with them?
Well, the Greater Bridgeport Symphony has been reaching out to the community for 70 years.
Mm-hmm.
And this is just continuing that process. We talked about Mahler, but honestly, it was just about music and friends. We talked a lot about Kendrick Lamar as well, who happens to be one of my heroes. And I know this sounds crazy, but listening to Pimp a Butterfly and Mahler 5, you can really draw comparisons because of great creations. You could say, well, it starts this way and it ends exactly the same, and there's like a line that goes all the way through. Mahler 5 says it's in C sharp minor but ends, you know, in a different key, and I feel like when you listen to Kendrick's album, you can't help but think that this was a true creation from top to bottom,
mm-hmm.
and not actually...
that he pined over every second of it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Piece to piece.
Yeah.
Well, what's your favorite part of the set that's going to be played on Saturday night?
I couldn't give you an exact moment. I think because it's like going to a great meal or having friends over for a great dinner is that, well, maybe it was the Bordeaux you were drinking, but maybe it was the fish,
yeah.
maybe it was the steak, or maybe it was just as simple as that very, very small piece of fruit that you had.
Everyone has different tastes,
you know,
so
yeah.
to speak, right?
And without everything, it wouldn't be complete.
Right.
This is your second year with the symphony,
yeah.
and you replaced someone who'd been there.
I replaced one of the great conductors of recent history, Gustav Meyer, who was here in Bridgeport for
right.
42 years, I believe, and actually an influence of mine, a teacher of mine, and really special
really?
to get to do that. Yeah,
he played violin.
He was a conductor.
He was, but he was also a violinist. Or?
That I don't know, but yeah. I should.
Yeah, you should. You should. It's interesting. Most conductors do have an instrument.
Most do. Quite often it's piano.
Yeah.
I think, you know, when you think about the instrument I just played, I played one note at a time, mm-hmm. more or less, and we could play two notes.
Yeah, I was watching your hands.
Yeah. But with piano, you could, you know, you play 10,
yes.
15, no. but you could play full chords. So you could sit down at a piano and read a symphony. So I think often pianists end up working with chordal sounds, which means can lead to a conductor possibilities quickly. You do have violinists, cellists, oboists, horn players that end up going into conducting as well. But it doesn't have to do with the instrument. It has to do with both desire, probably a good deal of narcissism, and sort of love of that repertoire.
And you also lead the Brooklyn Knights.
The
Knights and the Brooklyn Rider.
Brooklyn Rider is a string quartet that actually I've decided, very bittersweet, but to leave at the end of the season. I started that group. I started Brooklyn Rider and the Knights with my brother in the last 10 or 15 years, and the more that I think about what I want to do, you know, for the rest of my life, I'm 33, is centered around conducting and organizing that type of event, which is, I think, one of the more heroic things that musicians do, getting on stage and playing a symphony together, you know, 40 people or 100 people all with the same image and the same idea going forward. We are going to give you a moment as an audience member. How many times do you go an hour or two without looking at a cell phone or an iPod or an iPad or a computer? And I feel like the experience that is possible now in a concert hall, you know, live music, is one that you could actually detach in a very special way.
It's rare. It's very rare for people to have that collective experience.
Yeah, I've checked my email 3 times while sitting here with you guys. And, no.
Well, I have to confess that in certain concerts I've been in, it's totally annoying when people, you can see them checking.
Oh, yeah, you see the light.
You see the light.
People don't understand
the
light.
You just want to go.
They think it's not, they don't think it has light.
Okay, let's go there. Pet peeves.
Yes.
Even more so than the light, because I'm on stage so I don't see the light so much, is when someone at the quietest moment decides to pick up the wrapper and goes like this. And you just, what I don't understand is, do they not understand the concept of sound? And,
right.
You know, okay, so, yeah, so that's like my biggest pet peeve.
Well, that and people going, whispering.
Whispering's bad, but whispering, what actually whispering means no one else can hear it, because you could speak that quietly in someone's ear. But whispering, like, what movement are we in?
Yeah. What do you think so far? We should have you come on and do a segment of your biggest pet peeves.
Yes. Okay. Pet peeves. Yeah.
A follow up to every show.
Well, yes, exactly.
We have done a segment with our etiquette columnist on how to behave.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, we have done that.
Well, performances.
Okay. No, that's another thing. The etiquette of, you know, I think a lot of people know that at classical concerts, one is not supposed to clap between movements of a symphony. However, I think that's pretty ridiculous. And actually, there was a very clear time in history. It was Wagner who said the artist, it was right, you know, Freud, Wagner, that time when the word genius was sort of coming into regular culture. People were called heroes and geniuses, and music was written about that, and the composer and the conductor became these important people.
Huge, yes.
So what Wagner did was he put lights on stage and turned the lights off in the house and said, don't you eat, don't you smoke, don't you drink, don't you talk during my concert. You witness our art. Which, okay, there's something beautiful about witnessing great art and witnessing an experience. However, that's what museums often are for. Like, wow, I could go and see a Picasso. It's so breathtaking. However, in a concert where life and time are sort of connected and there's everyone's experiencing something at the same time, whether you're experiencing it differently because of personal, you know, internal battles that you're going through, that's fine. But that thing of not being able to express yourself, meaning like the end of Beethoven 5, first movement, well, applause is just necessary.
I know.
Piece so that there'd be applause.
You can't help yourself.
Yeah.
You can't help yourself. It's interesting. I went to a gamelan concert at the Indonesian consulate in New York, and it was set up as a very solemn thing with people sitting in chairs all around the performers. Mm. And my almost daughter-in-law said, you know, in Indonesia, people would be milling around, talking, and the music would be playing and they would be appreciating it, but they wouldn't be all just sitting focused on it.
I believe it.
You know?
I believe so.
That it's part of life.
It's different presentations of music.
Yeah.
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 Well, often when you go into a culture and extract something and not everything that goes around it, it becomes a different thing in your culture, right?
Yeah.
When bringing a Beethoven symphony to Indonesia, I have a feeling it's probably similar to bringing a gamelan here.
Right.
It'll be observed in a different way, and maybe that's as interesting as the original, just as a study.
Well, Eric, we'll have to have you come back on the couch soon and talk. You have another show coming up April 12th or 9th.
Yeah.
I keep 9th. Screwing up the dates.
April 9th.
April 9th. Yeah. You're excited
with
for that one?
One of the greatest cellists that's ever lived. His name's Jan Vogler. He lives in Berlin and Dresden and New York, and he's here, which is just really an incredible opportunity for the community to get to hear him.
So people that can't make it this Saturday, there's always the one in April.
And there's next
two great
year.
Shows.
And
then there's also
year.
Next fall, as Mark had pointed out. Eric, thank you so much for coming on.
Thanks so much for having me.
We'll be back on the couch next week to talk about St. Patty's Day movies.
Yep.
That should be a lot of fun.
And the Maritime
Aquarium. Tune in next week at 2 for Arts and Leisure. We sign off. Have a great weekend, everybody. It's all